Good morning, everyone. I'd like to thank everyone who's here for being here today. My name is Maribel Sanchez Ortega. I'm the chair of the Cultural Activities Committee, responsible for facilitating Mr. Kevin Powell's event here today. I'd like to take a moment and thank our sponsors, the Multicultural Services and the College Activities Board. We'll now be introducing Dr. Abe, who will be facilitating the presentation. Dr. Abe is a faculty member here at SCC, who has written two works on called Six in the Morning, as well as Emerald Street, A History of Hip Hop in Seattle. So Dr. Abe.
There he is. All right, well, appreciate everybody who came out. And it's nice to be up here at Central as usual. I would say that I first became aware of our speaker today probably around the time that most people my age first became aware of Kevin Powell. And that would have been kind of in the early to mid-1990s as the, I guess what would be known as the East Coast, West Coast hip-hop beef really started to take off. He was a writer, staff writer at Five Magazine at the time. And, you know, it's sometimes difficult to contextualize for people who are younger and do not necessarily have those memories of what was happening hip-hop wise during the 1990s to give a full sense of exactly how deep things had gotten by that time. By the time you get to the mid-90s, you have, like I said, this you had all the time in hip-hop almost from the beginning, from the time it came to the public's consciousness in 1979, with the release of the single Rapper's Delight. And once it started spreading to other parts of the country, you kind of had a little bit of geographic friction, if I can call it that. Because, you know what I mean, the job of the hip-hop MC has always been to talk about who you are, what it's like, where you're from. And so everybody was like, man, my place is the best. And so you had that, like I said, you had that creative tension as the 80s went on about, as the West Coast started to emerge, kind of rising up and giving a challenge to the hip-hop supremacy of the East Coast. And so as records started coming out and as magazine articles started coming out that were kind of documenting the rise of this friction in the 90s, a lot of it seemed very sensationalist, at least to me, as somebody who was very much invested in the music and the culture at the time. It just seemed like a lot of what was being written about, what was happening, and the two stars of this were Tupac and the Notorious B.I.G. But a lot of it, like I said, was just kind of egging on and wasn't exactly the kind of journalism that I would have expected given the climate of the time, as well as the violent nature that beef would eventually take. But I have to say that in reading Kevin's work during that time, I was impressed and pleased that someone would be taking a more thoughtful approach, a more journalistic approach, and not just be a cheerleader and cheer on whoever, you know what I mean, whoever's coast they were from, or whichever artist they liked better. And that was really kind of the first time that I had gotten a chance to read and experience a more thoughtful form of writing as it related to hip hop. Now, fast forward to me, you know, fast forward to me, 10 years, less than 10 years later or so, to the early 2000s, I'm starting here up at Seattle Central, and I get a feeling like, you know, that this place could use a hip hop culture course. Yes. And as I started putting the proposal together, it was people like Kev who inspired me, that made me think that this would be something that would be acceptable. That this was something that could function in an academic form if you approached it the right way, not just be, like I said, a cheerleader, and let's listen to these songs and that kind of thing, but really dig into a lot of these social issues around race and class and gender, using hip-hop as a lens. And the appeal to young people was immediate. As soon as that course was offered, I think there was like, the first quarter was offered, I think it was like, I'm talking about Humanities 125, Hip-Hop Theory and Culture here at Seattle Central. First offered in 2003, I think. The first time it was offered, maybe 27 or so students on the waiting list. So I mean, it was like, there was hunger for that, there was thirst for this. Now, fast forward a little bit further, up until 3, 4, 5 years ago or so, I'm participating in this hip-hop education conference in Harlem, in New York City, talking about this book, Six in the Morning, and who's there in the audience, and who approaches me afterward to talk about what I was talking about, but this guy, Kevin Powell. I'm like, man, you've been in the game for a whole lot longer than me, and here you are approaching me. That made me feel like, you know, I mean, that's what I'm talking about as far as like interacting with people and being of service. We hit it off immediately and stayed in touch. And when he came out here, you know what I'm saying, I would help him out with a little bit of transportation from a few of his speaking engagements, and on the way in between those, we had some fabulous conversations, and I got to hear some stories. Several of which you can find in his outstanding memoir, The Education of Kevin Powell, and some of which you won't. I read the book. Some of them were in there, some of them were not. I probably heard, I won't say I heard the better ones that weren't in the book, but I heard some good ones, some real good ones. And so as I've gotten to know Kev a little bit over the years, I have observed kind of not only in person, but kind of seeing how he puts what he's doing out there on Twitter, and just getting a sense of what it really means to serve and be about people. And even people who come across on social media and try to come at him the wrong way, whether it be trolls or just people who don't understand, you know what I mean? He is equally willing to work with and meet people where they're at. And I think that is a, you know, I mean, that is a true symbol of somebody who's here to serve all people and not just some people. And this is certainly even more of a relevant point given the events of the last several weeks. And so as I invite this man up here, I would just like to extend my appreciation to him, not only for his work, but also for our friendship and our chance to get to know each other a little bit better. And like I said, there's residue falling from the top right now. And this residue has a lot of kind of positionality written all over it. By positionality, I mean like elements of race and class and culture, starting from the very top office in the land. And that residue certainly is falling like unwelcome snowflakes amongst many people, and it settles at the feet of our youngest people. And I can attest to that because I have a 15-year-old daughter who is right now in the midst of dealing with that residue in terms of like racial issues at her school directed at her and that kind of thing. And although all of that is coming from the top, I definitely feel like it's grassroots people and movements that will do the best work in countering that. So without any further ado, and this man is right in the center of that, I can tell you. Tell you, he's right in the center of that, not just here, but everywhere he goes and he travels. Believe me, he gets his travel. Look at, you can check his airline miles. He probably got more than almost anybody I know. So having said all that, I would like to give a Seattle Central welcome to a man, an East Coast man, a New York man, who is actually openly rooting for the Seahawks to win the Super Bowl this year. Unless they play the Giants in the NFC Championship. But other than that, he's with us the whole way. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up, please, for Mr. Kevin Powell.
Hey, how y'all doing? Good. Can we come down? What I'm going to do is I'm going to come down, too. Can we agree to that? Can we just come closer? Please, everybody. Even if you have to leave, it's all right. I won't be offended if you leave early. Just please come down as a family. Please. Saying please, like into the middle. Can we go to the middle? That'd be cool. Is that cool? All right. Y'all over there, can y'all come to the middle? Everybody over here? Can y'all come to the middle? please. I'm asking because this is my last lecture of the year, at least that's the plan, my last presentation. And Dr. Dalby and Sammy, we're standing for the Sammy. Here we go. Oh, the beard, here it is. Can we give Brother Samuel and Dr. Dalby a round of applause, please? Can y'all come to the middle, please? And I want to also acknowledge the College Activities Board, the Office of Multicultural Services and Humanities Department. The reason why I asked you all to come to the middle, there's 52 weeks in a year, is that right? There's 52 weeks in a year. I think I've been on the road 40 weeks out of this year. You know, I don't remember, I think I can count once or twice where I was home for 2 weeks back, you know, consecutively. This last 6 days I've been in North Carolina, Bay Area, California, Seattle, Des Moines, Washington. I just discovered that. And I was in Vancouver yesterday. I took the train ride up, took the train ride back, and that train ride was cool. It was all right. And then I'm here, and I'm finally going home tonight on a red-eye flight. I'm tired, but I'm energized. I apologize for being a little late. I just finished a blog that's about 12,000 words long. It's mad long, but I had to get it out of me. Because there's this little thing that happened 2 weeks ago called the presidential election. And I've been sitting on this thing in my head for the last 2 weeks, and the blog is called America, Who Are We? And What Are We Going to Tell the Children? We're going to release it later today. So I was editing that thing. I've been up since like 4 a.m. Yesterday morning, this morning, Saturday morning, just writing this thing. You know, as a writer, Dalby knows, some of y'all, any writers out there? It is hard being a writer. And, you know, it's 40 pages, y'all. It's mad long. It's like a little book, but there's a lot to say. And what I want to do, if it's all right with you all, how much time do we have, Samuel? How much time do
we have? We have to 12.
To 12, okay. What I want to do is say a few words, if y'all don't mind. Is that all right? And then I want to make this interactive. Can we do that? Because I think it's whack for a speaker to come and just speak and you never hear the voices of the people in the community. It's, you know, that's important to me. But there's a couple things that are in my head that I want to just share with you all. Think about the blog, think about a few things. One, obviously, you know, let me just say this. I don't care if you're liberal or conservative, if you're a Democrat or Republican, if you voted for Hillary, if you voted for Trump, if you voted for the Green Party, Libertarian Party, whatever you did, that's your business. If you didn't vote at all, you have that right as well. I actually hate the fact that there have been a lot of people around the country shaming people who didn't vote. You know, I think there's something problematic about that. One of the things I say in my blog is part of the people that I know who didn't vote, and I vote in every single election. Their argument, which I agree with, I say in my blog, is the system is broken. The system is broken. There's something wrong with a two-party system where you really don't have a choice. You know, one of the things I say is that when I went to vote in Brooklyn, New York, you know, it was just Democrats, you know, and yet the Republican Donald Trump, but it's the same people every couple of years. You don't really have a choice, you know, at all. And if you don't have a lot of money, you can't run for office. If you're not wealthy, you can't run for office. You're not tied to people who have wealth, you can't run for office. I ran for Congress twice, 2008, 2010 in Brooklyn, New York. I'm very proud of the campaigns we ran, but to use Dr. Dalby's words, a grassroots campaign, we had no money, we had no resources, you know? And we were constantly told by people, they weren't Republicans, they were actually Democrats, because New York City's a Democratic city. Well, if you have some money, then we might support you. This is coming from the Democratic Party. They're supposed to be the party of the people. And so one of the things I want y'all to think about as we go forward in the next couple of years, or these next 4 years of Donald Trump as the president, I've been voting since the 1980s. I'm here to tell y'all, you know, and part of why I vote is because my family's from the South. My mother raised me to vote. I know the history of black people of color, women, all different types of people, 18-year-olds not having the right to vote. So I don't take the right to vote for granted. But I also know that the Electoral College is a sham. It's BS. You know, it has nothing to do with democracy. I also know that what really matters are those local elections around the country. That's why I participated in the voting process, you know. But since the 1980s, when Reagan and Bush were in office, the first Bush, I can tell you, as a political science major in College, Rutgers University, they basically all say the same speech. It doesn't matter if it's Barack or Bush first or Bush second. They all talk about, you know, some form of terrorism or communism. They all talk about, you know, military might. They always talk about make America stronger, that type of stuff. I can literally write the speeches at this point. You know, I've been listening to this stuff for 30 years at this point. And so I want to say to you all, you know, if we really are serious about changing this country, one book that we all should read cover to cover is called The People's People's History of the United States by Howard Zinn. A People's History of the United States by Howard Zinn. This is a white brother, a Jewish brother, who was one of the many young people, black people and white people, the young people who participated in the civil rights movement in the 1950s and 1960s. Howard Zinn, as he was working with black brothers and sisters in America, the South, he realized, man, I don't know anything about these people, about their history, about their culture. And then he began to realize, you know what, there's a lot that I don't know about American history. If you look at the beautiful diversity in this room, and I'm assuming there are folks here who identify as white, as black, biracial, multicultural, who are Asian, Native American, First Nation people, who are Latino, Latina, you know, who might be straight, who might be queer, you know, whatever your identity is. Some of y'all might be Christian, Jewish, Muslim, some of y'all might be atheistic, agnostic. His point was, we should know the history of all of y'all in America, equally, you know. And when I think about all the stuff that's happened over the last couple of years, not just this presidential election, but how Barack Obama has been systematically attacked, and trust me, I have critiques of Obama. My next essay, the last one written this year, is gonna be about Obama's 8 years. There's a lot to say, you know what I mean? I don't believe in putting anybody on a pedestal. We all should be held accountable, myself, all of us, you know? But you cannot deny that this black man, this biracial man, this multicultural man, who brought together an incredible coalition of people, diverse people, just 8 years ago, he has been constantly under attack over the course of these 8 years, obstructed. I mean, the Republicans have bragged about the fact they were going to obstruct him, you know, as he's going about his business. And you know that they're trying to tear apart Obamacare the moment they get into office and some other things. We know what may happen with the Supreme Court. We know what may happen with women with abortion rights and other issues that affect women in this country. Anyone who happens to be lesbian, bisexual, gay, transgender, queer sisters and brothers, you know, you have the right to be married right now. And you know, but will that last? Voter ID laws, you know, there's a whole range of stuff that we got to talk about. And what people in power have effectively done is divided us from each other. You know what I mean? Again, in the 80s when I was coming up, the fear was communism, you know, those Russians. Now it's Arab people, Muslim people, you know, the terrorists. And there's something wrong with a society where it's just constantly fear-based against people. You know, if you really look at American history, we've had a fear of Native American people, we've had a fear of black people, we've had a fear of Chinese sisters and brothers, we've had a fear of Vietnamese people, Italian Americans, Irish Americans, Jewish Americans. I mean, we can go just down the list. At some point or another in American history, some group has been a scapegoat, someone that we just blame for everything, and we're fearful of the other. That's what I call it in my blog, fearful of the other. And what I'm saying to you all as students, as young people, older people, whatever your background is, education is about knowing who you are, knowing who you are, you know, knowing who you are. You know, it's not enough to say anymore, well, I'm white, I'm black, I'm Asian, Latino, no, who are you? I'm Middle Eastern, I'm African. Where did you come from? Where did your people come from? How did they get here to this great state of Washington? Are y'all with me out there? You know, this is important. We need to know who we are. You need to fall in love with yourself, not in an egotistical way, but in a way that roots you in something. Like, I'm proud of the fact that I'm an African person. I'm an African descendant person. I'm proud of where my ancestry comes from. I know that it didn't just start with South Carolina where my mama and them are from, but we actually come from Guinea-Bissau, West Africa, because I traced my DNA. Why did I do that? Because it had been erased, you know, by the wonderful school system and the mass media culture that we came up in, you know. I was an A student, K through 12 growing up, and black history in 13 years of school might have totaled 2 pages. Might have totaled 2 pages. Black folks were slaves, you know, George Washington Carver, messed around with some peanuts, experimented with some peanuts. I didn't know what that was about, you know. And I just finally went to Tuskegee University where he worked with Booker T. Washington for years, and to see the amount of things that this man created from peanuts, from yams, from all kinds of fruits and vegetables, I mean, hundreds and hundreds of inventions that he never even bothered to patent, you know what I mean, is incredible to me. I didn't know that. Rosa Parks didn't give up a seat on the bus. Dr. King has I Have a Dream speech. That's black history. What did I learn about Latinos, Asian people, you know, Native American people, Middle Eastern sisters and brothers? Nothing. What did I learn about white sisters and brothers who are different backgrounds? Nothing. You know, you learn it from a certain lens, which is, here's Columbus, here's Washington, here's Jefferson, here's the Founding Fathers, here's Lincoln. You know, these are these savior figures, these explorers, they're daring heroes and things like that. It's always from the lens of heterosexual white males only and mostly. And as you watch Mr. Trump and Mr. Pence, and that transition team, and you look at the people that they are looking at for the various cabinet positions, 95% of those folks are exactly like the people we were taught about in the school system. That's what's going on, you know? Now people ask me, well, Kevin, aren't you afraid? No, you know what, I'm not afraid because I know what my people have been through in America. I know what we've survived. What am I gonna be afraid of? You know what I mean? I'm from the ghetto, man. I'm from the hood. I grew up tremendously poor, rats and roaches, no father, you know, not even thinking that there's a future for me. The other day when I was at this conference for black and brown young men, many of the young men said, you know what? I said, what do you hope for? They said, I hope to make it to 15. I hope to make it to 18. I hope to make it to 21. I hope to make it to 25. That was me growing up. I hope I make it to this age. You know what I'm saying? And so, you know, am I concerned about the state of the country, where it's going? Yeah, but if you know American history, if you know the rhetoric of a people in power, you know that the way you keep people divided is to keep them scared, keep them anxious, keep them tripping. You know what I mean? But if you actually read, if you study, if you travel, you actually get to know this country, you realize, wait a minute, this has all been done before. As they're talking about what they're going to do with Muslims or Arabs, sisters and brothers, well, they did that to the Japanese. It was called internment camps in World War II. Are you with me out there?
Yep.
You know, this is very, very important to understand. You know, Malcolm X said it best, history is a people's memory, and without it, we're devoted to lower animals. You know, and I believe, and this is just my opinion, y'all can feel whatever y'all want, we're all sisters and brothers. I don't care what your background is. I love all people, all people, all people, all people are my sisters and brothers. You know what I mean? I don't care who you are. And the one thing that we have to have in this world is love. We need love. Because there's so much venom and hatred out there. You know, as Brother Dawoodi said, I've lived in Brooklyn for a long time. One of the greatest music groups, pop groups, rap groups ever, the Beastie Boys, three Jewish brothers from New York. You know, we know that Adam York, one of the brothers died, one of the Beastie Boys died a few years ago. Just a couple of days ago, anti-Semitic markings, you know, Nazi symbols on a park named after Mizan in Brooklyn, New York. I mean, this is going on around the country. We've counted probably close to 500 incidents in 2 weeks since the election. 500 incidents. Racist, sexist, homophobic, transphobic, anti-Semitic. Yet we still divided from each other. And what we need to understand is, as long as people keep us divided, you know, from each other, they're going to hold on to that power, you know. And back to Howard Zinn, nothing has ever changed in this country's history. And back to Dr. Dawoodi, it has to come from the people. It has to come from the people. And so folks ask me, well, what do? Read, study, travel, get organized. If you're not organized, you don't have to do it. You know, some of us do. You don't have to be a campus administrator or a student leader. You don't have to be a scholar, professor, like the Dr. Dawoodi. You don't have to be a speaker like myself. But you need to do something while you're on this planet, for however long or how short you're on this planet, that's going to be about affecting change, not just for yourself, but for all people. That's critical. That's absolutely critical. And so I just want to put that out there. And understand, too, we've got to confront these isms. You know, we've got to confront these isms. Let me start with sexism. You know, I'll come back to the other ones, but let me start there. The day before the election, I spoke at the university I went to, New Jersey, Rutgers University. I was born and raised actually in New Jersey City, went to Rutgers, the state university. And I was brought in there to talk about rape culture. Y'all heard the term, obviously, right? I know the women have, the men, rape culture. And so in the midst of doing this conversation around manhood, and my position is, we gotta redefine manhood. You know what I'm saying? Because the reality is, for most of us, just like I didn't learn anything about Black history, the contributions of many of y'all growing up in the school system, now as an A student, K through 12. What did I learn about women K through 12? Betsy Ross sold a flag. Rosa Parks, Florence Nightingale, Helen Keller. Maybe fourth, Emily Dickinson was the only writer that I've ever heard of that was a woman, K through 12. Half the country's population are women. Half the world's population are women. And gentlemen, we need to understand that just like racism is race plus power and privilege, who has the privilege, who doesn't, who has the power, who doesn't, sexism is about power and privilege. You know? Did I know this growing up? Absolutely not. Did I know this in college? No, I was ignorant like most men. When I got to Rutgers University my first semester, I was actually told by some of the ignorant older male students on campus, man, there's so much sex happening on this campus that we don't need any electricity to keep the lights on. Basically, it was an invitation to disrespect women on that campus. It's out of control everywhere. It's out of control everywhere. And when I was at Rutgers University, some of the young men, you know, said they felt that I was making them feel stupid, quote unquote, or that I was demeaning them. I said, well, imagine how women feel every single day. Imagine how women feel every single day. The images that y'all, they are bombarded with from every angle, the mass media culture, you know, not seeing yourself in math, not seeing yourself in science, not seeing yourself in all these different classes unless you have a progressive professor, instructor who's making sure that their curriculum is inclusive of half the world's population. Are y'all with me out there? Why did they say they felt stupid or demeaned? I asked the men two simple questions. One, what is a man? You know the responses I got. A man is strong. A man is responsible. A man is accountable. A man takes care of his business. They went through the whole list. After they finished, I said what I say everywhere I go in the country. You just described my single mother who raised me by herself. Now can you actually tell me what a man is? No response, it gets quiet. Then the second question, which is a simple question. You know, can you name me 20 women in American history who have contributed to America? They say the same names that I just said. We might get to 4 or 5 collectively in the room. There's about 200 or 300 men in this room at Rutgers. After those 4 or 5 names, they don't know any of the names. You know what I'm saying? And I purposely say, you cannot name people in entertainment, you can't name people in sports. You know? That's part of the problem. And so when we think about the campaign that we just experienced, I can't speak for you all, but you have a man who's about to be president of the United States who said just a few weeks before he was elected, grabbed him by the y'all know what. You have a man who refers to his own daughter as a piece of ASS. You know, you have a man who has a rape charge by a girl who's 13 in the 90s that's still pending. He's trying to settle stuff very slickly, slyly, as he's about to go into the White House on January 20th. You have men around him, like Mike Pence, who clearly don't care about women. Look at his record, look up his record in Indiana if you don't believe me. You know, and what I'm saying to you, the men out there, even if you're not the kind of man who would ever call a woman a thought, an H-O, a B-I-C-C-H, who never, God forbid, you know, hit her, strike her, you know, rape her, engage in any kind of toxic definitions of manhood. Many of us have engaged in, like myself included, I talk about it in my book, I was destructive, I was backwards. I didn't know any better. Never was challenged on things. Because what boys do, we support each other, we encourage each other, you know? In fact, we police each other to engage in the sexist behavior. You know what I'm saying? But even if you're not the kind of male who would engage in any of that kind of stuff, but you have men around you on this campus, in your fraternity, fraternity, or any organization you belong to, your sports club, whatever it is, if you're a professor, instructor, administrator, student, community member that engages in behavior that does not respect women as equals, as equals, as equals, because women are our equals, are our equals, are our equals, are our equals, then guess what? You are as much a part of the problem as anybody else. That's it. And so we got to deal with this whole hyper-masculinity, this toxic masculinity. It's going to be on full display for at least the next 4 years. People can say whatever they want about Barack Obama. One of the things that I admired the most, because the first time I saw Barack Obama speak was in 2004 at the Democratic National Convention in Boston. He has always respected Michelle Obama as his equal and as his partner. You know what I mean? People can say whatever they want about Hillary Clinton, but you cannot deny the fact that this woman was way more qualified than any of the 17 Republican candidates for president and anyone on the male side. She had more better credentials than Barack Obama. She had better credentials than her own husband when he ran in 92, Bill Clinton. She had better credentials than Ronald Reagan. She had better credentials than Jimmy Carter. And so we can't deny, you know, regardless of what my critiques of the Democratic Party, believe me, it's in my blog. They need to be critiqued because they're an elitist party as well. But you can't deny the way she was treated. Utterly sexist. Utterly sexist. Just utterly sexist. You know? And so, we gotta think about these things. Racism, we gotta think about. You know, there's a lot of back and forth going on the social media. I pay attention. This is why it's taken me so long to write this blog over the last 2 weeks. I've been reading everything I can and listening to stuff on the internet. And the thing that's really interesting is that, you know, majority of white folks voted for Donald Trump. You know? And again, we're all sisters and brothers, but I think that we gotta look ourselves in the mirror. What kind of America were you voting for? You know, whether you publicly supported Mr. Trump or privately, because you're afraid to say to someone, I voted for Donald Trump. You know, I'll give you an example. A couple weeks back, I was here in Washington State and in Oregon, but it was in Washington State. I think, I'm trying to think where it was at. It was in Spokane. I had a white brother who was a cab driver. Simple question. I always engage people. So what do you think about the presidential election? Oh, man, Hillary Clinton, she's going to turn this country into a Muslim country. I said, really? How's she going to do that? She already has. He had no facts, no research, nothing. He was simply regurgitating, repeating what he has heard over and over again. And if you don't read, if you don't study, if you don't travel, you don't understand that education is being a critical thinker, you're gonna have other people thinking for you. And he actually believes that this is what's happening to the country. No logic. And he voted, of course, for Donald Trump. I'm in South Carolina. And I want you to think about this for a second. I'm a black man whose people are from South Carolina. I get invited to a literacy conference and talk about diversity. The conference is being held at a place called Plantation. I walk up in that joint, and I'm like, the New York comes out of me like, son, are these people serious? They're gonna invite a black man without telling him to a gathering that's supposed to be about him talking about diversity and inclusion, and don't even tell him that the place he's speaking at is called Plantation. So you know, I got up there and I said in my first 3 minutes, y'all really need to think about, you know, where y'all host stuff in the future. Well, it might not be a big deal to you because you're seeing the world through your racial lens. These are 99.9% white sisters and brothers. You know, part of the racism or sexism, homophobia, transphobia, you don't have to be a person of color or a woman or a queer sister or brother. You just have to have some empathy and some compassion. Are y'all with me out there? You know what I mean? And this racism thing is serious because what has happened is that the Republican Party has effectively, the conservative movement has racialized everything. You know, there's no more, it's not like it was back in the day when my mother grew up. She was born in the 1940s in the South for whites only signs, for colors only signs, but they'll use coded language. We're gonna build a wall. You know? Muslim terrorists or Muslim extremists, these are all racial codes, y'all. You know what I mean? This is what's going on. They're taking our jobs overseas. Well, who are those people? I guess they're talking about Latin America and Asia. You know? Even with the Native American brothers and sisters who are, y'all need to support those folks dealing with the pipeline issue. Even those sisters and brothers are being told they need to go somewhere. I'm like, how are they gonna go somewhere when this is their land? Where are they going? You know what I mean? But racism is a cancer, you know? And there's so much ignorance around it. You know, you actually have people saying, if you even bring up, when I spoke at one place, I'm not gonna say where, this white brother actually, he and I actually got into a car conversation. I want you to think about this for a second. I'm tired. I'm freaking tired. This has been a long, hard year. On top of all the work we've had to deal around the presidential election, all the grassroots stuff, the number of times I've had to watch black people being killed by the police on video, exhaustion, I'm traumatized by that. Y'all with me?
Yes.
You know what I mean? And then, you know, what y'all don't know about is all the work we do in the community back in New York City with our organization, resources, services. If you're a leader or organizer, activist, whatever term you call yourself, you gotta help people. That's your job. It's nonstop. You know what I mean? There's no breaks from this work. And, you know, this gentleman didn't like what I said in my speech last week. He said, you got political. And I said, let me remind you about George Orwell. You ever heard of him? He said, yeah, Animal Farm. I read that in high school. I said, well, you got some more Orwell to read because he wrote many essays as well. And one of the things that George Orwell said was that everything is political. Like, everything is political. You know what I mean? And so they try to play these games with you. You got political. Why did I get political? He said, well, you talked about the presidential election. Well, I happen to be in the great state of North Carolina, which happened to go for Mr. Trump, which I found problematic. You know, I find it problematic that they're so caught bent out of shape where transgender sisters and brothers are going to go use the bathroom. Don't we have more important things to worry about than when people go use the bathroom? I don't care who's in the bathroom. If you got to use the bathroom, I got to use the bathroom. You go to the bathroom, I go to the bathroom, we good. These folks are tripping over stuff like that. And then we know that the votes got suppressed in places like North Carolina and Florida. Just votes missing. You know what I mean? And so me and this gentleman were actually on the phone from midnight to about 1:30, 2 in the morning, going back and forth, and I finally sat to him. I said, with all due respect, sir, as a white brother, you're actually talking to me the way certain types of white men have talked to me my entire life, which is patronizing, which is condescending, not respecting me as an equal, and you actually think that you own me because you're paying me an honorary to come here, and therefore you're gonna control what I'm saying. Are you with me?
Yes.
And unless you are spineless, unless you're a coward, I don't care what your background, as a person of color, as a woman, as a queer sister or brother, you know, whatever your background is, never let anybody tell you who you are. Nobody. You know what I'm saying? Nobody. You know? And that's what's going on in this country, is that there's a certain group that wants to really take the country backwards to where we can dictate who people are and who they are not. You know? They mess with the wrong Negro. I'm not that cat. You know what I mean? I'm not that cat. And so to me, there's a way to love people, all people, bring us together, but also never get caught up in this kumbaya stuff of like, you know, we all should just get along. No, it means we gotta do some work here, y'all. It means we gotta do some real work here. You know, you can't call yourself a progressive person in your sex. You can't call yourself a progressive person in your race. You can't call yourself a progressive person if you're homophobic and transphobic. You know, here I'm standing, you know, I'm standing on the shoulders not just of the Malcolm X's and the Ella Bakers and Fannie Hamers, but I'm standing on the shoulders of folks who happen to be queer, like James Baldwin and Bayard Rustin, y'all, and Audre Lorde. This is serious here. And so how am I going to go around being homophobic and transphobic? Are y'all with me? Yeah. You know? And I know a lot of folks got off on the term deplorables when Mrs. Clinton said that. I actually thought that that was disrespectful. What is the difference between calling people deplorables, no matter what you think of their politics, and calling people trailer trash, poor white trash, illegal aliens, ghetto, hood? Are y'all with me out there? It's called classism. It's called classism. You know, and there's a reason why those working class white sisters and brothers and other white sisters and brothers voted for Donald Trump, because the Democratic Party is elitist. And I've been a lifelong Democrat, but it's elitist. It's bourgeois. It ain't about the people. This is why Bernie Sanders had the effect that he had on a lot of people, because he spoke the truth to people, you know? And so I just want to leave y'all with that. I would prefer, at this point, if we can just open up the floor, but let's have the courage to tell the truth. Let's ask the hard question. Let's challenge ourselves and challenge each other. And then I think, you know, honestly, how many of y'all came to college because you want to make more money in life? Just for show of hands, any of y'all came to college? No shame, I put both my hands up, my legs up too. My only response to that is, you know, do I want to go back to the rats and roaches I grew up in? Absolutely not. Do I want to go back to just one pair of shoes and one pair of sneakers when I was growing up? And if I ran a hole in my shoes or sneakers, it was no new shoes or sneakers. We had a cardboard or newspaper in the shoes or sneakers. That was my life. I'm from the East Coast, so that meant frostbitten feet in the wintertime. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? I don't want to go back to that. But at the same time, one of the things I realized when I got to college, you know, there's different ways to be rich. And one of the most valuable ways to be rich is your mind. You know? If you came to college to make money, what college degree does Steve Jobs have? What college degree does Bill Gates have? Seriously. Thank you. But they were constantly intellectually curious, and they had vision. You know what I mean? So the question becomes, and I want y'all to graduate, I want y'all to go to four-year schools, do what you gotta do with your lives. But we need people in these times who are gonna be like Malcolm X, or Gates, or Jobs, or Dr. Maya Angelou, who only had a high school diploma, but she was such a prolific writer, she got several honorary doctorates. That's how she became Maya and Dr. Maya Angelou. Malcolm X, eighth grade education, 7 years in prison, my hero. But in prison, this man took learning so seriously, he realized, man, I can't read my own handwriting. And so let me start by reading the dictionary, the letter A, the word aardvark, and he ended up becoming, when he got out of prison, as y'all should know, and everyone in this room should read the autobiography of Malcolm X, one of the most important texts about American history you could ever read, one of the most dynamic leaders on the planet. On the planet. 7 years in prison. But he never stopped learning. So, make your money, but more importantly, what are we going to do in service to other people? That's my question. So, thank y'all. Let's have a dialogue. Let's have a dialogue. Anyone? Just say your name, social security number. No, y'all good? Y'all good? With yourself, with ourselves. You know what I mean? Don't be afraid. I mean, you know, don't be afraid. It's like, why am I here? What's my passion? You know, when I was with the high school boys on Saturday in Des Moines, Washington, that was a constant question. What are y'all passionate about? You know? You should not major in anything that you're not actually passionate about. If it's something that you're just trying to make some money off of, I mean, you're not going to be happy. What are you passionate about? You really can't serve your community if you're not doing work that makes you happy. Like what I do as a writer, as a speaker, as an activist or public servant, whatever it's a term you want to use, it doesn't feel like work to me. Am I tired a lot? Yeah, but I actually love every day of my life. I can't say that. I've always been able to say that. When I was a full-time journalist, it was cool for the first 2 years working at Vibe. The last 2 years, it sucked. Be honest with you. Got myself fired, you know, because I was not happy being in the space where I felt like I was constantly under pressure to produce something. And a lot of times, I wasn't even interested in what I was writing. You know what I mean? I'm not talking the Tupac stuff, yes, but the other stuff, which a lot of folks don't know about, I didn't like it. You know what I mean? Yes, ma'am.
I would just like to add something about Howard Zinn. I heard him speak, and
Is there water, by the way?
Yeah, I left it out.
I was just asking for water. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah. Because I think it relates to part of what this election was about. I attribute our election of Trump to the lack of critical thinking on the part of people who heard the phrases, more jobs, you know, this kind of thing. And they didn't, you know, I heard educated people say, he's a businessman. Well, he screwed his employees, he's, you know, failed businessman. So, lack of critical thinking. And I just want to bring that back to Howard Zinn as an example of we must be critical thinkers. Howard Zinn was a pilot during World War II.
That's right.
Because he thought, he wanted to get into the fray for saving the world, for democracy, and doing what he thought was good for people. And I'm sure a lot of the Jews in Europe, were pleased to have people like him.
That's right.
And he was flying over Dresden, and Dresden is a horrible point in the war, and he saw that he was bombing citizens.
Yeah.
He wasn't bombing other fighters, and that was a turning point for him.
That's an excellent point. Critical thinking. You asked where do we start? I think part of it for me, going back to when I was 18, 19 years old, I had to rethink everything that I had been taught up to that point. But didn't happen again when I was in my 20s, when I had to start rethinking gender, So what have we been taught? We've got this little holiday. Thank you so much. We've got this little holiday coming up on Thursday. What's it called, Joe?
Thanksgiving.
And it's a wonderful time to get together with family, but I don't know how anyone who's a critical thinker can sit there and say Happy Thanksgiving, especially this part of the country with so many First Nation people, and not even consider that holiday actually has to do, along with Columbus Day, the genocide of indigenous people. Are y'all with me?
Yes.
Critical thinking. Back to Howard Zinn. He makes it a point in the first part of A People's History of the United States to say, I'm going to debunk this myth of Columbus and the explorers and what really happened to First Nation people. Tell the truth. I don't know about y'all, but I can't participate in lies. That's not an education. Part of the reason I was an A student, K-12, is because one, my mother said, you gotta go further in school than me. Two, she did not tolerate bad grades. And three, my education just really was memorizing what the teachers gave us, and I gave it back to them really well. How's that an education? It's not an education. You're a robot. You're a parent. So where's the critical thinking at? So let's start there. We gotta ask ourselves, what do I know? If there's something that was said today, question it. You should question everything. Question the speaker, question everybody, but you should actually do your research. Something you said has really stuck with me. When I was in South Carolina, I had a cab driver as well, just like the one in Washington State, Spokane. They literally just repeated what they heard. There was no research. And the tragedy of these times, y'all, we are in the midst of a technological revolution, what we call the information age. You know how many times I've had to say to people who reached out to me on Twitter and Facebook, have you thought about Googling that? Have you thought about looking that up? How many of us have posted stuff? And I've been guilty of it, and I take it very seriously now. Just reposted something without even reading it ourselves. To the point where Mark Zuckerberg now on Facebook has admitted they need to put something in place on Facebook because people keep putting fake news out there. Y'all with me? Where's the reading at? We don't read. A lot of us don't read. Or we'll read what we're told to read, and we don't think outside of that. How many of y'all would have a fit if you didn't eat for a couple of weeks, if you didn't eat for a couple of months? Imagine now what happens to your mind when we're not constantly feeding our minds with critical thoughts. What happens? We're not evolving. We're not growing. We become the person that says that Hillary is making, she's already made the country a Muslim country. And there's no even reality to that. Just making stuff up. And like she said, because I've worked in the entertainment industry and pop culture for a long time, everything is reduced to catchphrases, sound bites, make America great again. It was no different with Barack Obama in 2008, hope and changing, yes we can. Does anyone even know what his policies were? What he's running on? Does anyone even know the platform? No one knows. A lot of people don't know. Because no one even bothered to read or look it up. Yes we can. Hope and change. So we gotta go deeper. Anyone else? I have hope, y'all can smile. I have a lot of hope. I love that hoodie, hope. We gotta have hope. What is the point of us going to school doing this if we don't have hope? You know? Yes?
So, my name is Adrian.
Hey, Adrian.
I was at a housing conference on Saturday, talking a lot about housing justice and gentrification and disability and access. And a lot of, it was a queer focused conference.
Oh, good.
We were talking a lot about the way that queer folks have been dispersed around the city because Capitol Hill is no longer accessible financially to lots of folks, and how that mirrors the gentrification going on in communities of color, and that we are all becoming more and more geographically distant from each other in various communities.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what your thoughts are on how we can, whether in a very grassroots way, how we can organize around bringing each other together and having those like strong communities, whether it's ride sharing or communal living, or like what your ideas are, what you've seen work well for bringing people together.
You know, I'm glad you asked that question. There's a church, a progressive church in New York City, Manhattan, in the village called Judson Memorial Church. And it's one of those places where the whole community knows that they're welcome to it. And so you can imagine every type of people we can think of is in that space, and we call people together. And I think it's going to take visionary leaders like yourself and some other folks saying, hey, we have these things in common, you know, around gentrification, around housing issues, some basic civil rights, some basic human rights. You know, don't deny who you are. There's some things that are unique to the queer community, some things that are unique to the Black community, unique to folks who are women or identify as women. But what are the intersections? That's that word again, right? What are the intersections here? And part of the problem that I've seen all around the country, Adrian, is a lot of folks get caught up in their silos. And, you know, we end up starting to compare, well, my oppression over here versus my oppression over there. We've got to be able to do both. It's not an either or. There's some work that I do that's specifically for the Black community, some work that I do specifically for Black males, you know what I'm saying? But at the same time, you know, I've got to be able to cross, what does Bell Hooks call it, cross-cultural boundaries. Got to do both. So I think we got to challenge people, challenge the leaders, like, can we sit down and talk about this issue? I'm watching Seattle. Has it been great growth from Seattle? Yep, it's just like Brooklyn, New York, where I'm from. And guess what? Brooklyn has gentrified queer people, people of color, working class women, artists of all different backgrounds have been pushed out. Same, sound like Seattle to y'all? You know what I mean? And then the question also becomes, again, in this era of social media and technology, are people in Seattle, in Oakland, in LA, in New Orleans, in Brooklyn, New York, are we all having conversations with each other? You know what I mean? What ends up happening is that I'll have a conversation with Brother Samuel, I'll have a conversation with Brother Dawoodi, you know, they're in Seattle, I'm here. We realize, hey, this is going on. But this needs now, because of what just happened, if y'all don't think that the right wing is organized, look at what they're doing as they transition into the presidency January 20th. Where's our organization at? There's a lot of things I can say about the right wing in this country, but I can definitely obviously say they've been organized for at least 40 years. You know what I'm saying? It's been at least the last 40 years. And they've been tremendously organized, probably for the last 50 years, if you really think about it. But where is our organizing? But I also think that's going to force us to have some uncomfortable conversations, because the reality is you're going to have people who might be white and queer who are still racist, and Black folks over here or people of color might say, hey, I have a problem with what you just communicated. You're going to have some people over here who are people of color who are homophobic or transphobic who are not going to work with queer people. We've got to get people out of their comfort zones. You know what I'm saying? You know? And it's very easy for us just to roll in our circles, but my thing is like, you know, what are you willing to do to get out of your comfort zone? If you see this as a problem, and you see that unity is the strength there. The thing that was deep to me about the conference with the young boys, they were high schoolers on Saturday. African-American, Latino, Asian, Native American, Middle Eastern brothers, they kept talking about the word unity over and over again all day. I was like, these kids are thinking outside of the box. You know, this is my brother, this is my brother, this is my brother, you know? But how many of us really believe that we're all part of this family together, you know? And then it means that we've got to do some education, you know? It's that serious. And we got to be honest about what we don't know and what our fears are. And I think we have to say, if we bring people together, this is a safe space and no judgment. Because some things might come out of people's mouths that you're like, man, I can't believe that person just said that. And the thing with progressive people, we is as bad as anybody else. Got you. I knew you was homophobic. I knew you was racist. I knew you was sexist. I knew you was anti-Islam. You know, I knew you was anti-Semitic. No, maybe they just don't know what they don't know. And part of our job is to help people along. We're really serious about building coalition. You know, so thank you for asking that. Yes, ma'am.
So
Okay.
Both my parents are from New Orleans, so my grandmother didn't read or write, like neither one of them. But my parents have always been like really like on my head about education and like, you know, getting a doctorate or like, furthering your education. But I've always had like a lot of people telling me like, are you gonna go to a university like and let white people or whatever like brainwash you? Like I have like a lot of friends that tell me that. And so I just wanna know like what's your opinion on furthering your education? Not that I agree with like the brainwashing stuff, but I guess like the system or whatever, because I was thinking maybe being an activist, but I don't know like where do you start? Like what's the education requirements? Do I have to further my education through this? Like can I do this?
I mean, it's a great question. It's a fair question. I mean, first of all, I understand why your peers are saying that because of the times that we're in. And, you know, one of the things I think, how are you under 25?
I'm 21.
Okay. One of the things I admire about, how many of y'all are millennials out there? Millennials. I love y'all. It's like 83 million of y'all in the country. Y'all are the biggest generation since the World War II generation, actually, since Mr. Zinn's generation. Y'all question stuff in a way that I haven't seen in a long time, which I respect and admire, as you should. But what I would say in response to that, you used the word system, I mean, you're a woman of color, you're a young person, and so we could argue that someone's trying to tell you what to do as a young person, as a woman of color. Back to her point, critical thinking. That's gotta be the foundation of your education. College gives you, in my humble opinion, our skill sets, access to things that you may not otherwise have, you know what I'm saying? To navigate your way through, you know? My assistant, for example, she just graduated from Mount Holyoke College in June of 2015, asked her to come work with me. She's applying to get into an MFA program now at New York University. What we've talked about for the last year and a half, Taylor, is you gotta arm yourself with as many skill sets as possible for the rest of your life. That doesn't necessarily mean college is for everyone. What college degree did Malcolm X have? But he never stopped learning. The best education to me is self-education. But some of the things I learned about how to get a self-education came from my going to the best schools in Jersey City where I grew up and going to college. You know, whether I finish or not doesn't matter, but I picked up certain things that have been useful for the rest of my life. You know what I'm saying? And I've always added on to that. And I think, you know, you gotta think about if y'all are leaders, forget the word activist for a second, if y'all are leaders, what are the tools in my toolbox? Because I meet a lot of people. And I'm gonna say this for a second, and I'm not one of those older adults who condemns young people. I think it's mad corny, and it happened to my generation in the 90s. But what I'll say is that you've gotta be prepared. If you really wanna serve your community, the most important thing you can do is be prepared. You know what I'm saying? So when I'm in college, I'm joining student organizations, what did I learn in college? How to speak in public, how to run meetings, how to formally run meetings, how to do budgets, how to do proposals. I can produce any kind of event, conference, summit, we can do reports, studies. You feel where I'm going with this? I meet a lot of people who say, well, I want to do something in the community. You start asking them about basic skills. They have no skills. They have no skill sets. They just have passion. That's only going to take you but so far. You'll be the person yelling at every single rally and protest. F the police or whatever it is that you like to say, and that'll be the extent of it. You know what I'm saying? Down with gentrification, down with homophobia, down with trans. You'll be reduced to slogans just like the right-wing people. But if you actually have skill sets, you know, what are your skill sets? That's the question I think we gotta ask ourselves. What is it that I can actually do? What do I need to improve on? You know what I mean? And what can I get from this education here and then four-year college? And if I decide to go beyond that, what's my vision for myself? I'll give you an example, Dr. Naeem Akbar. You know who that is, Dr. Naeem Akbar? He's one of the foremost authorities on black psychology in this country. He went to one of those schools you described, what your friends are talking about, University of Michigan or Michigan State, one or the other. Got a PhD. The moment he got his doctorate, he's like, I'm gonna take this piece of paper and I'm flipping this psychology over to my community. You feel what I'm saying? Because I'm clear where I'm needed with this piece of paper and my skill sets that I got from doing this is over here. You know what I mean? So that's how you look at it. But you know, you show me someone who's telling these people not to get an education, I'll show you someone who's gonna be stuck on that metaphorical corner for the rest of their lives. You know what I'm saying? And you're not of any use to the community. You're hyped up, you're mad. But like, yo, what can you actually do? You know what I'm saying? I mean, When I say my training as an activist, it came from organizations. It came from reading and studying constantly, knowing the history, knowing the current events. To me, if you're sitting up being an activist, a leader, you got to know history, current events, you got to know who you are, you got to know social media, technology, you need to know pop culture, you need to know hip-hop, which is the dominant youth culture the last 40, 50 years. You got to know sports. You know, the last time I was here, there was a young man who got up and he was mad that folks were hyped up about the Seahawks. I think y'all had just been in the Super Bowl or something like that, if I remember correctly. And I, you know, he was condemning people. I said, yo, you just took a tool out of your toolbox. You just eliminated the conversation with a whole bunch of people in Seattle because you just dissed the Seahawks. That's ignorant. Whether you think sports is frivolous or not, guess what? That becomes a conversation that leads you into other things. Because what part of the thing being asked, people need to see that you're human too. You know what I mean? Can I actually relate to this person? So as much as I post serious stuff on my social media page, I also post about sports, I post about music. I happen to love those things. And so why would I downgrade those things now that I'm an activist, a revolutionary? You feel what I'm saying? Nah, man. But I also share stuff that I think will empower people. What do you mean to be an activist? You know, 25 years ago, I wasn't a vegan. I wasn't a yogi. Self-care was something that was never said to me as a young person. You gotta take care of yourself as you're doing this work in the community. I believe deeply in self-care because I've seen a lot of us burn out. As soon as I get back to New York, I'm back to my routine of taking care of myself. And this is draining work. And understanding that activism is a marathon, it's not a sprint. This is, if this is what you're gonna do, this is the rest of your life. There's no getting around that, so. Anyone else? You're thinking.
I just showed up with your Seahawks reference that sort of crossed up in my head. I hear, you know, the fallout of the election, a lot of things that people have been saying is, you know, we need to get to the table with people who are different than us. But a lot of those people are people like white nationalists and things like that. Am I taking a tool out of my toolbox by not being willing to have conversations with people who, you know, more or less don't want anything to do with being a brother or a kid?
Yeah. That's a hard one. I mean, I personally will talk to anybody, at least have one conversation, and see if there's any openness whatsoever. Because, I mean, I know where the brainwashing, you talk about brainwashing, that's the real brainwashing, where you've been taught to hate people that are different than you, and that you're superior to everybody else. You know, I've had those conversations in person with people. I've had it on social media with folks. You know, I think the most important thing again is like, are you prepared to have that conversation emotionally and intellectually both? You know, if you're really rooted in your studies and you know this country's history in a way that they don't, they're speaking from a very narrow lens, you know, have the conversation. You know, you're not gonna get bent out of shape. Like, people know it buttons to press, you know, and I'm someone who, how many of y'all have had some anger issues in your lives? Anybody? Oh yeah, that's why 25 years ago. Here, I believe in therapy. Mental health is mad real, y'all. Mental health is mad real. Now when people say crazy stuff to me, I'm like, all right, son, you good. You know what I'm saying? Back in the day, I would curse you out. I'd be ready to fight you straight up. Because where I come from, if people say some crazy stuff out their face, you swing on them. But I'm like, I'm about peace and love. You know what I'm saying? But I also believe that sometimes if you have conversations with people, like say, for example, I'll have conversations like that on Twitter with people. Sometimes I realize I'm not changing the mind of that person, but it's all the silent people who are listening to the conversation. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'm saying it to the law. Like the other day, I'll give you an example. The other day I spoke in California about campus rape, sexual assault. We were talking about gender issues earlier. And what I said earlier, I'll say again, since you're here, some other men have walked in. You know, men, we have got to take a stand against sexism. We've got to take a stand against sexism. We cannot be folks who benefit, you know, at the expense of women and girls for the rest of our lives. If you're opposed to oppression, you gotta be opposed to all forms of oppression. I got two men who hit me up on Twitter. As soon as the program was over, I didn't even realize it was being live streamed. What about the men who get beat up by the women? I said, well, sir, this is such a small percentage, but I'm not supporting any dysfunctional abusive relationships. I don't care what it is. None of us, heterosexual, homosexual, queer, transgender, however we define ourselves, no one should want to be in an unhealthy relationship, right? That's rooted in violence. Anybody? Right? So that was my first response. And the second response is, well, the statistics say, sir, that over 90% of the cases are men beating up women, or raping women, hurting women, sexual assaulting women. And then he flips it to, well, the Department of Justice report says only 3% of these cases exist in the country. I said, well, sir, what you're leaving out is the number of women in the country who never report their abuser. You know what I'm saying? And on top of that, even if it's just 3%, if the country is 300 million people and half of it is 150 million, that's at least 5 million women. You're gonna tell me that's a small number, even if that's accurate. You know what I mean? But then I realized this man simply wanted to argue. He was not interested in learning about gender issues. And so I said, let me just talk about this in general terms for all the folks who are listening, because his mind's not gonna be changed here. Does that make sense?
It does.
You know what I mean? And he pissed me off, to be honest with you, because one thing I cannot deal with are ignorant, sexist, homophobic, transphobic dudes, and I'm a straight dude saying this, you know what I mean? But we wallow in this ignorance, man, this machismo, you know what I mean? And it's we don't even realize how destructive this is even to us, you know? So we gotta think about ways that we challenge people. We have to challenge, we have no choice but to challenge people, you know? Anyone else? Yes?
Which, I mean, you're just not like Eminem, Snoop, or anything, but it's for that reason, which that's his opinion and whatnot, but, you know, so many other things have taken over because white people will say, like, we're wrong people, that's right, we're African Americans, and now it's, like, predominantly white people. So is it a fear for something being taken over?
Yeah, that's a great question. And these are the kind of conversations you gotta have. I mean, you're talking about cultural appropriation. Talking about historical hurts. You know, when you talk about this, like, if y'all get a chance, there's a great art cover story on the Rolling Stones. They got a new album out for the first time, I think, in 11 years. And so they're interviewing Mick Jagger and Keith Richards. And one of the things that they talk about, the new album, y'all know what I'm talking about? They have a new album that's based in their early history. They love the blues. And a lot of the British invasion groups, including the Beatles, were all deeply inspired by African American music. You know what I'm saying? And one of the things that Keith Richards said that really stuck with me in the interview, he said, man, rock and roll lost its soul when basically it got gentrified and African Americans removed from rock and roll. I believe he's talking about that period where all of a sudden, probably post Jimi Hendrix, and even Jimi Hendrix was considered weird by people by the late 60s, but he was one of the only black folks that was still making quote unquote rock and roll, you know. And so I understand why my people, black people, feel that way, because if you take away black folks, there really pretty much isn't much of American music. You know, let's be real about it. Spirituals, blues, jazz, you know what I'm saying? Hip hop, you can go across the board. Rock and roll, I mean, rock and roll is a black term. It's a term that men having sex, you know what I'm saying? Jazz men having sex. These are black vernacular terms. And so I understand where your friend's coming from, but the danger of that, and I used to think like that too, is that we get stuck there, and so we don't see the merit in people. You know, I actually think Eminem's a talented artist. Do I agree with everything he says? My issue with Eminem is less that he's white. It's the sexist stuff. It's the misogynistic stuff. He's representing the worst forms of patriarchy, like a lot of other men in hip-hop. You feel what I'm saying? And so, you know, he's fighting the wrong battle. He's like, well, he's white, you know, man. The other thing to understand is that, like, you know, hip-hop was created by poor people, poor African-Americans, poor Latinos, and poor West Indians in New York, and then it was a parallel energy in the western part of this country, poor African-Americans, poor Latinos. But there's no way that hip-hop, it's a global culture, inevitably, young people of all different backgrounds would be touched by it. Just like in the 1920s, you had young white brothers and sisters inspired by jazz. In the 50s, rock and roll. People are gonna go towards, young people always go towards the culture, the music that's rebellious, that reflects their energy of their generation. You know, that doesn't mean everyone loves it, but it's there. And even, how many of y'all have used the term, I'm good? How many of y'all have said dissing or diss? Even if you're not a diehard hip hop head like me, you've been touched by the language. You know what I'm saying? And so I think that your friend is wrong there, you know? But I do think there needs to be a different conversation about the history of cultural appropriation. That's a conversation. Like, I love the Bee Gees, for example. Love the Bee Gees. I love John Travolta. I have a whole chapter in my book called John Travolta. Disco was a part of my childhood. But the reality is, underground, working class, black and Latino queer people created what is called disco. But the Bee Gees are the ones who benefited from it. You feel what I'm saying? We gotta have those uncomfortable conversations. The Bee Gees also, what are they known for famously with their voices? How did they, the high voices, right? Well, where did they get that from? The stylistics, the dramatics, a lot of the early 70s soul singers who sang in falsettos. The Bee Gees' career was actually down the tubes. One of their managers said, you should listen to some of these soul records and imitate this. That's when we got the Bee Gees of Saturday Night Fever that made millions of dollars. What happened to all those black soul groups? Where's their money at? You know what I'm saying? So we do have to have those conversations. Madonna was voguing. Where did she get voguing from? Black, Latino, queer people. She made it popular. Where are those folks at? You feel what I'm saying? Elvis is the king of rock and roll, but why is Little Richard, 80-something years old, Chuck Berry turns 90 this year, why they still haven't performed? And they really, I mean, who was a greater songwriter than Chuck Berry? You know, Rolling Stones, all these folks that came from over Europe, they like Chuck Berry, Chuck Berry, Chuck Berry. When you hear the Beatles sing, early song, what do they do in the early song? Woo, right? That woo thing? Where'd they get that from? Little Richard. Where'd they get it from? The Isley Brothers. You feel what I'm saying? Where did Little Richard and the Isley Brothers get it from? The black church. But if we don't read, we don't study, we don't know our music, our culture, our history, you know, your friend is reacting on an emotional level to stuff that he's got to be able to articulate beyond that, which is, this is why I feel this way about Eminem, and he's right. Eminem is allowed to talk about a range of stuff in his lyrics, but if you're a black artist, you got to not do what you talk about. Do the homework. Eminem has even said it himself. It's been documented. But we've got to be able to articulate that, because we can't just be us responding on an emotional level. This is why I hate this person, because he's white, or he's this or that. No, you've got to be able to say, because you've done your homework, this is why this is problematic. You know what I'm saying? And it's not really Eminem. It's back to your word. It's the system. Music industry is a system just like everything else.
What is it wrong for artists like Macklemore and him to be
around? No, Macklemore's my friend. I love Macklemore. I don't care what anybody says. You know, but I've watched my own people condemn everything Macklemore does. They just, no, man, he's white, son. I'm like, so? You know, no. I mean, but when people have been oppressed, what I've noticed, listen, any people have been oppressed, it could be black people, people of color, women, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender people, any group of people have been oppressed, poor people, we are more likely to be hypersensitive to everything. And I understand it. I get it. I'm a man of color. But part of the healing work, otherwise oppression is dictating your whole life for the rest of your life, is that you just can't react to everything, and everything is this. You know, I actually say to my own people, and I'm always going to be opposed to racism. I'm always going to talk about racism, about white supremacy. I'm not apologetic about it. But I'm like, every time you say something that's racist, you actually cheapen the legitimate conversations about racism when there's really something racist. You know what I'm saying? You know? And I mean, honestly, I don't know what Eminem, what else Eminem can do. He looked out for the brothers around him. You know what I'm saying? I mean, he's done a lot of stuff. I don't even know. But I get it. A lot of us are emotionally wounded, deeply emotionally wounded by these various systems of oppression. And, you know, we don't really do the work. To me, the best example is Malcolm X. Malcolm X, before he made his pilgrimage as a Muslim, you know, to Mecca, he said some very hardcore things about white people. Look it up. But when he's over there in Mecca, he's like, wait a minute, I'm seeing people with blonde hair and blue eyes praying right with me who are also Muslims. I might want to rethink how I talk about certain things. Does that make sense? In other words, Malcolm was constantly evolving. A lot of us don't evolve. And even those of us who claim to be activists, leaders, progressive, all that stuff, we don't evolve. Artists don't evolve. We just keep saying the same stuff over and over again. That's dangerous. That becomes as dangerous to me. It's like it's internalized oppression. Does that make sense? You know? Understand where he's coming from, but challenge people. The fact that you said he's your friend means that he values you somewhat as a friend, right? And you identify as a white sister. You know what I mean? So, you know, I just think that, you know, and trust me, y'all, there have been few people that I know who have been as angry as me. When I was in college, I didn't drink white bread. I didn't drink white milk. I didn't eat white bread. Anything white, I didn't want anything to do with me. This is my book. But imagine being stuck there into your 40s. And this is how you see things. And you don't have, I mean, imagine all the conversations, all the connections that you cut off while you're just being stuck there. There's two types of anger. There's proactive anger. Let me take this and be a bridge builder, then it's destructive anger when I'm destroying bridges all over the place. Which one do you want to be? You know what I'm saying? I'm not compromising my identity as a black person, an African person. I'm clear who I am, but I also want to be a bridge builder. Does that make sense? So, anyone else? Are we good with time, or anyone else? Yes.
My name's Vanessa, in the last year, became super obsessed with Hamilton the musical.
Yeah.
And so, for those of you that maybe don't know what it is, it's the story of Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr, basically, and how they say right from the get-go, the Aaron Burr kills Alexander Hamilton. And it's a story that I hadn't really heard of, and Alexander Hamilton, I was like, yeah, he's on the $10 bill, that's what I have. But what was really interesting is, A, their approach of using hip-hop and jazz and different types of music, but also that they told the story of Alexander Hamilton, who was so prolific in writing and so intelligent and basically created this system that we have today in terms of finances, which take that as you will. But also he was a loudmouth, annoying, and cheated on his wife, all these kinds of things. And I was like, why are they writing this musical about this guy? He did horrible things. And I was watching this documentary about it, and basically it helped me see this and actually apply it to other people in terms of looking at people holistically, not just giving them one identifying factor, but looking at them as a whole person. He was both outrageously prolific and outrageously intelligent, but also did some bad things and made some poor choices, and that he's both of those things at the same time. He's not one without the other.
Yeah, that's a great point. I'm glad you brought that up, especially in light of, have y'all heard about Vice President-elect Pence going to the play in New York on Friday, I believe, and then the cast asking him to stay so they could read a statement to him about diversity in America. Well, the play, you know, to the credit of, it's created by a Puerto Rican brother, Lin-Manuel Miranda, you know, who stumbled into the story of Hamilton. A lot of us know the story of Hamilton. I had heard years back when I was first starting off as a youth activist that Hamilton, he's biracial, he's mixed with something, he's born in the West. He really wasn't born in the Caribbean, you know. And that was one thing that's thrown out at them. And anyone, someone said they have roots in New Orleans, so you've heard the term Creole. That was used on you as well, on Hamilton. And so he's this interesting young man, self-made, you know, made his way to New York as a teenager, made his way into get an education, became a successful lawyer as well. I mean, he was truly a Renaissance person. And I've always wondered about, you know, you hear about Washington, you hear about Jefferson, you hear about Ben Franklin, but they never talk about Hamilton, but the play kind of explains it. And then what's brilliant about what Lin-Manuel did, this Latino brother, he decided to cast the founding fathers and mothers of this country as people of color. He flipped it. And then used this culture created by people of color called hip-hop. It's deep. And literally it sold out. I saw it in June. I was blown away. It says, brilliantly written, brilliantly acted, brilliant choreography, the whole nine yards. And it forces questions about democracy and freedom. And boy, do we need that right now. You know what I'm saying? It's powerful, but it also, you know, was, if you really listen to the play, you also hear Hamilton grappling what was going on in this country, slavery. Most of those founding fathers owned slaves. You know, they're talking about freedom, but for who? You know what I mean? Make America great, but for who? What's the difference between that and Donald Trump today? And so, has it come through Seattle yet?
No.
Okay, y'all should see it. I really recommend it. It's an incredible piece of art, you know? Incredible piece of art. Anyone else? Yes, please.
I wanted to go back to your point about two different types of anger.
Yeah.
In light of the recent elections, there have been mass riots, destruction of property, and there also have been peaceful protests, but it seems like a large part of the media is focusing on the negativity of it. And I agree, we do have the right to be angry, but when it comes to putting that anger into aggression and destroying property, what would your response to that be?
I'm a man of peace, but like Dr. King said, a riot is the language of the unheard. And a lot of people don't feel like they're being heard and haven't been heard for a long time. And I'm going to say this to you all, there's no way, unless you've been living in a box for the last 2 years, let's be honest about it. The things that have come out of Mr. Trump's mouth have been so traumatic, so disrespectful to so many different types of people. How could you not be affected by it? Build the wall, grab them by the you-know-what, you know, the African-Americans. Oh, I got an African-American over there. I mean, literally, this is all on camera. This is on video. We're not going to be pissed off. You know what I'm saying? Especially, it looks like we're going from 8 years ago, as I said earlier, where we had this incredible coalition of diverse people putting Barack Obama in office. We're not going to think about Barack Obama in 8 years. There was something very magical about people coming together. Now we have the worst polarization I've seen in my lifetime. You know, and I've seen some ugliness. And so, you know, do I condone violence? No, but I understand where it's coming from. And, you know, I think people kind of pick and choose what they condemn in terms of violence. I hear people talk about, well, I condemn the violence, I condemn the rioting, but I don't hear people as loudly saying they condemn police brutality. You know what I mean? And when people have the same passion and energy condemning police brutality across the country, which is real, like I could literally walk out of this space right now and get assaulted just because I'm a black man. That's real life. It's real like that. You know what I mean? It's real like that. And I want people to have the same zealousness. Like, well, I gotta, let's condemn all forms of violence. If you want to condemn the rioting after the election, then let's condemn dropping drones on people all over the world. Let's condemn that. Let's condemn domestic violence. Let's condemn violence against women. Let's condemn violence against queer people. Should we go down a list, y'all? Let's condemn, you know, what happened to Native Americans with the pipeline. Am I right? Let's condemn that as well, the violence that was just levied against them. Let's be consistent in our condemnation of violence, because what I often find is people kind of pick and choose what upsets them. Does that make sense? You know what I mean? And so, yeah. I mean, if y'all do anything else, check out Dr. King's Vietnam War speech, April 4th, 67. You know? He said, you know what, I can no longer be silent about violence because you got this thing called Vietnam where we're destroying Asian people, Vietnamese sisters and brothers. But y'all telling me to be nonviolent in America, and you're asking me to condemn people rioting, quote unquote, in America. Same issue, this is, these are people, working class people out there who are frustrated. You know, you want to see, I hear people all the time, sister and everyone out here, sisters and brothers, talk about poverty. Like I go overseas to do work, I'm like, man, I'll bring you to Brooklyn, New York, where I'm from, you'll see some of the worst poverty you've ever seen in your life, right in New York City, with all the wealth. With Trump Tower and all the wealth there, some of the worst poverty. You know what I mean? Why wouldn't you be upset about it? Why would anyone be happy with being poor? Especially when you have wealth flaunted in your face from every single angle, every single day. You know what I'm saying? So do I can support violence? No. But what I also don't support are systems that are violent against people in the first place. You know what's really violent to me? An educational system that teaches doesn't teach people who they are. You know what's violent to me is a mass media culture that puts out stereotypes over and over again. You know, what's violent to me is when I was in high school and I didn't want to go to college, first generation college student, my guidance counselor didn't even bother to send up my applications. Luckily, I went back and sent my applications off. That's a form of violence, and that's educational malpractice. You know what I mean? What's violent to me is when I went to integrated schools as a little black boy in the fourth, fifth grade, a white male who was an adult actually said to me, because I had confidence in myself, because my mama taught me confidence, you have a chip on your shoulder, you need to get that off your shoulder. That's violence. So violence is not just physical destroying things, it's mental, it's spiritual, it's verbal. You feel what I'm saying? And so I think we need to get close to all forms of violence. Anything that hurts people, I can't support. And also understand there's always a cause and effect. Like, what is causing these people to act out? You know what I mean? Why are they pissed? What we tend to do is blame them for what they're doing, but we don't look at why they're doing it. Where did it come from? Gentrification in Seattle might be a problem. That might lead people to do some things, you know? Anyone else? Yes, sir?
Just a quick one. Moved over here from the Bay Area, and a lot of times we protest down there, we block the interstate.
Yeah.
It's a lot of negative reaction in general out here. Things like, I agree with what you're protesting about, but this isn't the way to protest. How do you define the way to protest?
There's no way to protest. Yeah. Let's go back to one of the great American philosophers, Henry David Thoreau. Read his essays about civil disobedience. I mean, do y'all really think y'all would be sitting here, this diverse group of people, civilly, if it wasn't for folks who, think about all the black and white folks who sacrificed their lives in the 60s, civil rights movement, and other sisters and brothers as well, you know, so that we could actually sit civilly together in 2016. What did they do? They got on buses, they sat in, you know what I mean? They block stuff. The same stuff we're talking about today, you know? And so when people say that, it's because they don't want their comfort disrupted. And they benefited from people sacrificing like us. And so my response is, well, ma'am, sir, human being, I believe in democracy. I believe in civil disobedience. We're not hurting anybody. Back to her point, the sister's point back there. But you know what? You all need to be aware of what's going on. Dr. King called it, Gandhi called it, it's creative tension. What's wrong with creative tension? You know what I'm saying? Now, until I die, I'm gonna write. I'm gonna, you know, we have our organization, nonprofit organization, so we do stuff in that space, but whenever I need to, I'm gonna be out in the streets blocking stuff. I got a feeling over the next 4 years, I'll be out in the streets quite a bit blocking stuff. You know what I'm saying? So that's my response. But again, back to, you gotta be in a, boom, here's the history. You realize nothing has changed if people did not use their voices. And we use our voices in different ways. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am. And then here.
So I think there's a lot of focus on individual acts and so holding individuals accountable, which I find important. But how do we change that conversation so that we're also engaging in a conversation around systems of oppression and institutional racism that really is the blanket for all of this?
You say it, you say it, you say it. You know, I'm not focused on, like, my blog, for those who came in late, I have a blog that's going to be up later today, probably on Huffington Post, called America, Who Are We and What Are We Going to Tell the Children? I'm talking about systems of oppression. And so I think we have to name it. Bell Hooks always says, name the oppression, name the systems that you're talking about. For her, it's patriarchy, capitalism, you know, racism. That's what she says. That's her way of looking at it. Patriarchy, capitalism, racism. These are the things that permeate everything. That's her view. Bell Hooks is one of our most dynamic feminists of the last 40 years, 40 plus books. I think you can't be afraid to say it. This is what it is, you know, and challenge people on it over and over again. You know, and you take, it takes a, when you challenge the system, you challenge it on your college campus. When I was at Rutgers, we challenged the racism of our school. You know, it sounds like these times we challenge the racism and the sexism and the homophobia and the transphobia and the classism, all of it. You know, we have to do those things. You know, I think that's important. When I was at the school last week in North Carolina High School, it was one of these elite prep schools in North Carolina. You know, the students were like, we want to challenge some stuff. We're not getting curriculum that's diverse. Well, I said the system's the problem. They are just teaching you Columbus and Thanksgiving and nothing else. Y'all have to challenge the whole system. It can't just be professor so-and-so or teacher so-and-so. You have to say, here's what it needs to look like. We want to deconstruct this thing. We want it to change. That's what we got to do. Yes, sir.
So you talked about self-care, right?
Yeah. It's never enough. It's endless, man. Yeah, let me tell you, like, I'm mad tired. I keep saying that. I'm gonna get on this red-eye flight tonight back to New York. My self-care tomorrow is to sleep all day. You know, or have my laptop and I'll work from my bed. That's where, that's as good as it's gonna get. But like, it's one of the things with activists, and I've been an activist for 30 years. It's like, a lot of us don't deal with the self-care piece. We're just constantly running. You know, it's dangerous, man, you know? I checked out. Guess what? The work is always gonna be there. The community is always gonna need help. Someone's gonna always need something in the community. There's always gonna be a rally, there's gonna always be a protest. But where's your me time, man? So I make sure every day I carve out time for myself. Does that make sense? You know what I mean? I gotta have quiet time because it's loud, man. This work is loud and hard. And so how old are you, sir? 23. I wish when I was 23, I wish when I was 18. Like, I never took advantage of the counseling center at Rutgers. Therapy is important. Therapy, counseling is important. I was an athlete growing up in high school. I ran track all 4 years in high school. Man, I didn't run again until my 40s. You know what I'm saying? We should work out. We should take our health seriously. Veganism is important to me. Anyone else out there vegan? Vegetarian? Chicken and fish? No judgment. If you eat meat, that's cool. Just how we eat the food. What are we putting into our bodies? Do we treat our bodies as sacred, or do we treat it as garbage cans? You feel what I'm saying? That's self-care. You know, whether you're religious or spiritual or agnostic, atheistic, do you at least carve out a couple moments every day just to be silent, to be still? You know, words of affirmation. Those are things that I see as self-care. You feel me? And then there's certain music. As much of a hip-hop head as I am, I'm a diehard hip-hop head. I can't listen to hip-hop 24/7 like I used to. Nah, man. Sometimes it's classical music, sometimes it's jazz, sometimes it can be Native American music, it can be music from India, it can be music from Mexico, just anything that's gonna feed my soul. Laura Nero, it can be Solange's new album, which is like a therapy session all into itself, you know what I'm saying? But I gotta have music that is not just constantly telling, you know, coming at me in a way that's like, does that make sense? You know, part of the reason why I took the train to Vancouver yesterday instead of flying, because I'm like, man, I just wanna chill for 4 hours going, and chill for 4 hours going back, and just look at the grass and the trees. Self-care. You know, a couple years ago, I'm like, man, I'm flying up there, I'm flying back, boom, boom, boom. What's up, son? That's crazy. You know what I mean? So you gotta make it a part of your life. It's gotta be a part of your life. You know? And people always say to me, well, this is your lifestyle. No, this is my life, man. I'm not gonna take care of myself. You know? Yes, sir. I'm in control of my life. I mean, I work for myself, so that's a little, you know, and I've worked for myself for the past 20 years, but I just think you have to demand it. Even if you have a job working for someone else, y'all got a gym on this campus. I know y'all got a gym on this campus, right? You know what I'm saying? Every school's got a gym. Y'all got a counseling center, right? Right?
Not
You have to. What'd you say?
We have individual counselors, but not a center.
Okay, thank you. I just think that you have to demand, like, you know, this has got to be a part of my routine. You know what I'm saying? Because if you're, you know, like, when I was coming up as a young activist, I knew that my routine was constantly being at rallies, at protests, at meeting after meeting after meeting after meeting after meeting, or conference calls, or whatever it was. But nowhere in there was, let's eat healthy. You know what I'm saying? Nowhere in there, let's exercise. Nowhere in there was like, let's take a moment, just chill. Now, every day is in there. Does that make sense? You know, and people who know me know Kevin ain't getting down with nothing. I used to drink, I smoked weed, I smoked cigarettes, I did it all, man. I'm good, I've had it. I mean, especially if you grow up in the hood, like 15 in the hood is like being 25. You gotta add 10 years, man. We exposed to stuff that you couldn't even imagine other places. So I was drinking malt liquor when I had no business drinking malt liquor as a kid, you know what I'm saying? Stuff they only sell in the hood anyway, you know what I mean? And so, take care of yourself. Why not? You know? Why not? Any other questions? Yes.
So when it comes to having conversations with people that you know have different understandings and different values than you do, and you're trying to either find a common place or just kind of get them to understand what you're saying, how do you find yourself getting past that barrier of different values?
I mean, I'm being dead honest with you because I don't believe in lying. Sometimes I'm effective at it. Sometimes I absolutely suck at it. And I think about this year. I've had some wonderful places this year where me and someone else who totally disagreed on stuff, we found common ground. We just kept talking. The key thing, we also listened. And then there were times this year where we both just kept talking and no one was listening. And there was no common ground. Does that make sense? Listening is a really important skill set to have if you're going to do this work of service to other people, whatever your work is. You got to listen. Sometimes I didn't listen because of my own ego. Sometimes my own insecurities, my own shaky self-esteem at times. Sometimes I just wanted to be right, to be honest with you. You know what I'm saying? We got to be honest about it. We're all work in progress. We're all works in progress. No one's perfect out here. But I think the critical thing is to be honest about who you are, where you are. You know, and I can't lie, there's things that affected me this year. Prince dying, David Bowie dying, all these people have died this year. That's affected me. The police brutality cases have affected me. The presidential election has affected me. You know, I've actually, you know, back to self-care, you know, what I decided is that I want to actually work on how I do what you just described, sir. And so after I do an annual holiday party and clothing drive for homeless people every year. We're on our 16th year next week, December 2nd. I've told everybody, yo, I'll see y'all in January. I need to shut it down. Because I don't want to be that cat that's snapping on people at the end of the year. You know what I mean? Because I know where I'm heading right now. And that's why I had to get it out with this blog and let it get out. And luckily, I'm a writer. I can get stuff off my chest that way. But I think you guys also have to know when it's time to take a step back. Because you know what? Maybe I need to work on my communication skills here. Does that make sense? That's mad real, man. You know? This has been a hard year. Hard game for a lot of people. So, anyone else? I know we have books outside for sale. I'll sign them for folks. And you want to say something, Sam?
I was just wondering if you might be able to speak to the.
Oh, sorry.
No, my bad. I'm wondering if you might be able to speak to the group about kind of, how, especially amongst groups that you agree with, even amongst agreements, you find disagreement where the call out culture as opposed to calling in,
yeah.
And how that, especially with the internet and the lack of human interaction, accountability.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, he asked that question. How many of y'all on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, Twitter, any of those things? You have anybody in your life, like you post stuff all the time, they never respond, and then you post that one thing and they come at you, got you. You know what I'm saying? That's happened to me a lot this year. It's like we've been reduced to a culture of, like what you said, this gotcha culture. We want to one-up people. It's crazy. I try not to participate in it, to be honest with you. Like, my rule of thumb is I try not to argue with people, and I have on social media, but I just feel like it's at a certain point, you just become the entertainment for other people. Like, so-and-so's going back and forth. You know what I mean? Like, this whole thing with Kanye calling out Jay-Z and Beyonce the other day, or Kanye calling out Taylor Swift, or Kanye calling out this person. I mean, Kanye just called, you know. And I'm hoping that Kanye just gets off of Twitter or social media and stops performing for a while, because I don't even know what that's about. But I just, when there are people who are like-minded folks and we're going to disagree, I mean, these are some of the conversations I'm thinking about. These are folks that I've actually reached out to. I said, look, you know, we're in the same struggle. We're in the same battle. We're fighting the same issues. It doesn't make any sense for us not to be talking to each other. Some folks have agreed and said, you know what, you're right, let's talk this through. Then there are folks like, nah, man, I won't ever talk to you again. You know what I mean? And all you can do is just say, I would like to have a conversation with you. That's all you can do. That's all you can do. And I hate to say this, Brother Sam and everyone out there, you know, we've talked about the right wing today, but like, as bad as Donald Trump talked about a lot of people, have you noticed they're all now coming to the White House, coming to him and saying, okay, we're gonna be a part of this transition thing. People on the left, so-called progressive, liberals, militants, radicals, revolutionaries, whatever y'all call yourselves, people will have beef with each other for the rest of their lives, which is crazy to me, you know what I mean? But I've seen that. My rule of thumb, one of my homegirls, her name is Robin, but she goes, she's a DJ, DJ Reborn. She always says to me, unless someone does something completely egregious to you, completely horrific and horrible to you, do not get into the business of just throwing people away. Does that make sense? Just don't throw people away. If someone hurt your feelings, say, well, you hurt my feelings, or you didn't communicate in a certain way, or I don't understand where you're coming from, just talk it through. Just talk it through. But we can ill afford, I feel, at any time, because we're serious about changing this world for the better, for folks not to even figure out ways to get along. That doesn't make any sense to me. You know? It just doesn't make any sense at all. Back to love, man. Do you really love people? Or are we just paying lip service to this stuff? You know? Yes?
I'd like to add something to that. I do not engage in any of the social media, and that's by design.
Why not?
Because I'm old school, and I believe in picking up the phone. I do email, okay. But I like to talk to people,
yes,
and I spend enough time on the computer with email that I don't want to get involved in all the other stuff. And I'm not dissing all the other stuff. I think there's value, and I have a 34-year-old daughter who's very political, and she, you know, posts stuff on Facebook and all. And I just want to add two things about that I've learned from her. One is she thinks that the left is spending too much time, you know, about just going back to what you were saying about, you know, arguing and fighting kind of stuff. She thinks that the left spends too much time talking about, you know, is it PC, is it not, you know, something you talked about a little earlier before I had to leave. You know, just talk with people, engage people, even if somebody may say something that, you know, you find offensive, let them know that. She said the right, you know, they've got it. The Tea Party's got it. You know, they don't have all this quibbling over this kind of stuff. And the other thing is she was engaged in a back and forth thing, the political thing on Facebook recently, and she said to me, you know, two of my friends just kind of turned on me. I was surprised at what they wrote, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, you know, I think Facebook is starting to cause problems, and she took issue with that. And she said, well, how's that different from when people used to write letters to each other? And I said to her, the difference is Facebook is public, and letters were private.
Exactly.
And I said, now you need, I'm not saying you shouldn't have posted what you posted, but now you need to get in touch with those two friends and talk to them personally. And she that made sense to her. She was very concerned about whether she was gonna lose these friends.
And that's happened to me. It's funny you bring it up. So part of the reason why I do use social media, besides I love it, is there's a billion people on Facebook, there's a half a billion on Twitter, you know? And as an organizer, as an activist, I always believe what Frantz Fanon said, rest of the earth, meet the people where they are, you know? And this is one of the spaces that they're in, you know? And I think that's important. But I agree with you. I refuse to, how many of y'all have had heated arguments via text messaging? Isn't it crazy? And you're trying to figure out the tone, the meeting. Y'all know what I'm talking about? How many of y'all have lost friends or colleagues via text messaging or social media? Okay, a few of us. I almost feel like there's something very inhuman about that. I agree with you. I believe in picking up the telephone if I can and talking to people voice to voice, you know? The only way I cannot is like, because I travel so much, I'm in a time zone and I'm just tired, and you know? But I agree with you. I think, you know, and I'm thinking about one particular conversation with a person who's a super progressive, and this person doesn't want to talk to me. And it started on email, and then it went over to Facebook, and then it went to text messaging. And I kept saying, can we talk on the phone? No. And the response was no, and you don't respect my boundaries. I'm like, I don't know what the boundaries are with social media and texting and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? It's crazy. So we don't even talk now. I said to myself, let me give it a couple of months and put a call out there and see if this person will talk to me again. It's ridiculous. And I even said to the person, this is ridiculous. This doesn't make any sense. We're supposed to be allies. You know what I'm saying? I think that a lot of people don't even realize how much this technology, social media, controls our lives. This is, to me, truly Big Brother, but back to George Orwell, what he was saying in 1984 has come to pass with all this technology. That's what I believe. You know, I think it's Brave New World, Huxley's book as well. You know, and I just think that social media should be a tool, but it should not be the main tool. I'll give you the other example I think of in New York City. I use cabs and Uber a lot. What I've noticed, how many of y'all use GPS? How many of y'all from Seattle, Seattle metro area, the suburbs of Seattle, either or? Now, how many of y'all actually can say that you know Seattle or the metro Seattle area without a GPS?
That's good.
But a lot of people don't. In New York, I can't tell me how many times I've got into a cab. No one even thinks for themselves anymore. They put on Waze, they put on GPS, whatever it is. And I'm like, this doesn't make any sense. I once drove across country from Atlanta to California. Before all this happened, all we had was a map. And we just kind of felt our way along. So I think there's something that's going on, which I agree with you, sister, where people don't realize how this stuff is thinking for us and controlling our lives in ways that are actually not helpful, they're detrimental to our lives. And so I totally agree with that, which is why I will never stop doing stuff like this, which I think we have to have interaction. I believe in meetings with people, you know, community meetings, community gatherings. It can't just be a Facebook group. There's something wrong with that, you know?
Yes.
I agree that social media is a great tool in terms of like bringing people together for a cause or to express your opinion on a cause. But the thing that I think I notice, especially with my age group, is people are like slacktivists. It's like, oh, well, I posted a Facebook article, or I liked that, or yeah. I whatever. You know, I checked in for the Standing Rock, so I did my part and now I'm done. And I'm really critical of those people because I think that A, it's a good tool, but it's not the complete work. Lives can be changed on Facebook,
that's
I don't
right.
think. And so how do you encourage people to take it off Facebook and to actually like live those values in their lives without doing the call, you know, without calling somebody?
Invite them to something. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's something that they're interested in. Maybe it's the Seahawks game. Maybe it's a music thing. I mean, people love music, right? People love sports, right? You know, invite them to something. So you can kind of begin to have that human connection. I also feel that a lot of people, when they're totally dependent on this stuff, our social skills are terrible. Really terrible. A lot of us have no social skills because everything is tweeting and texting and Facebooking. You know, and it's funny when you mentioned Standing Rock. When I first started seeing on Facebook, checking with Standing Rock, I actually thought people were actually at Standing Rock. I was like, that's a joke. I said, oh, people go to Standing Rock. This is amazing. And I'm like, man, this person's in New York. They chilling. You know what I'm saying? That's not activism. That's a part of it, but that's not. Would you agree? And you mentioned, I'm not a big fan of the term old school, but I just think you don't throw away everything from the past. You know, you take some of the new stuff, you take some of the old stuff, and you remix it in a way that works for you. Does that make sense? That's what I feel, you know, and there's nothing beats that eyeball to eyeball, face to face stuff, you know? So, yes, and in here. Can these be the last two? Okay.
So talking about call out culture, the structure of allyship seems very much about making voices that cannot be heard. That's how privilege works. It silences people. It's not just about power or influence. It's about who can't be heard, who doesn't have the network, the power, the leverage to be taken seriously.
Yeah.
And I've always been so thankful of people in my community that will, like, someone says something kind of messed up.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, you're with your family, or you're with a group, like, I'm with, like, a group of white queers, and someone says something racist. Like, there are people that will use that, like, bit of call-out culture to be like, that's messed up. And I, because I'm oriented toward peace and gentleness, I always have a hard time, like, stepping in and being like, no. You know, I'm wondering what your thoughts are around building powerful, dedicated allyship against racism and xenophobia and Islamophobia, all those things. without becoming hostile toward each other, creating gentle, kind communities for each other where we are like holding each other accountable without being violent, right? Without creating social anxiety for each other and like destroying interpersonal relationships, but still working toward making unheard voices heard.
Well, I think it's a great question. The circle of activists that I work with in New York City, we say it, we lay out the groundwork. Here are the ground rules. This is how we want to operate. This is the kind of space that we want to be in. You know, we're going to talk about all these systems of oppression. You know, we don't want anyone to feel like their voice doesn't matter, that their spirit doesn't matter here. But we also want people to feel comfortable enough to challenge each other with love. It was bringing back to with love. And I think that we have to be careful of taking it to any extreme. Like I just read an article the other day, and I'm sure I can remember who the writer was, but she talked about how you have folks who do this work who are afraid of moving beyond peace and being kind. It doesn't mean you be rude to people, but if someone says something that's very disruptive or toxic or oppressive in some way, you have to challenge that. You have to push back, as we say, you know. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Hey, I have a problem with that, you know, and here's why, boom, boom, boom. And people are willing to do this work, then they gotta be willing to engage in these conversations. And it's gonna happen at different points, you know. I always talk about, the other day, when I was first challenged as a man, or as a heterosexual man about sexism, you know, women came to me and said, hey, they didn't condemn me, they didn't curse me or anything like that, but they said, you have got to do some work. This is in the early 1990s, you've got to read some things. Here's stuff to you to think about. So they actually came with a whole, you know what I mean? And was it comfortable reading that stuff? Absolutely not. As a man, I was like, holy cow, they're talking about me. You know what I'm saying? But if there was the approach, if that makes sense. You know, even when I think about the young men from my college that I talked about who said that they felt stupid or demeaning, I have to be honest with you, I've actually gone back in my mind and said, Kev, that was the first time you've ever had so many young men in a setting push back so hard when you brought up the issue of patriarchy, of masculinity. It's because of the way I came at it, because I'm exhausted by that. I was exhausted by the election, all the ridiculousness by that point. It was the day before the presidential election. And so I also think we gotta think about the approach, but don't stop speaking your truths, and don't stop speaking about justice. That's our responsibility, we have to do it. You know, even when we don't want to, we have to do it. So, someone, yes, sir.
So I just wanted to come back to that idea of like Facebook and online activism, kind of.
Yeah.
So I think that a lot of what we see online is just instant gratification. But I think a lot of it as well, and you just touched on it just now, I think, and then also earlier talking about organization. But I think it's really a failure of people to, you know, organize that. You know, there's a lot of energy.
Please buy the book.
There's a lot of energy out there, be it online, but there's nobody, it doesn't seem like there's organizations actively trying to harvest that energy.
Well, there are. There's MoveOn.org, there's ColdChange.org. There are a number of groups online that are specifically there because they know a lot of us are on social media on a regular basis. You know, so they do exist. Check out MoveOn.org, check out ColdChange.org. There's quite a few, and I'll be honest about it. My iPhone, a lot of the work that I do, like I'm pressing buttons, and this is organizing for me, but I also know how to organize offline. You know, that's something I said to people, you know, how to organize in the community, not just with your smartphone. You know what I'm saying? And also, you know, we who are older, you know, or who know the world before all this existed. I remember 20 years ago when I was at Vibe magazine, they announced that we were gonna have email. We were like, what's that? You know what I'm saying? We're like, we don't want email, that's crazy. Little did we know, my cell phone was like this big 20 years ago. It was crazy with an antenna coming out. Can you imagine? You know what I'm saying? But I've had to evolve with the times, you know? And so I just want to be careful because I love millennials. I love the energy that millennials have brought to our country, you know, both born in the 90s into the 2000s. My thing is like, just know the history and know that, to the sister's point back there, there's gotta be balance. That's all we're asking, where's the balance at? You know, where's the balance at? Does that make sense? It's like when I meet a lot of heads who say they want to get into the music industry, but all they think Tupac and Biggie are old school. I'm like, there was hip-hop before Tupac and Biggie. You know what I mean? There was rock and roll before Nirvana and Pearl Jam. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, you gotta actually know this stuff. I remember when it was announced that Bob Dylan won the Nobel Prize for Literature, people were like, well, who's Bob Dylan? I'm like, man, are you serious? Or like, remember when Kanye did the song with Rihanna and Paul McCartney? People were actually like, who's Paul McCartney? Y'all know who Paul McCartney is, right? Just checking. But so balance is my response to that. Like, there's nothing wrong with doing the work online, but what are you doing offline? Does that make sense? Yeah. So it's got to be both. Thank y'all. I'm going to come up and sign some books for y'all.